So hello everyone. Some of the participants have joined.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, so it will be so nice of you if you can switch on your cameras, maybe for few minutes, few seconds, so that I can get a feel that I'll be interacting with the real people instead of profile pictures or just the names. Thank you, Professor Lakshmi, Dr. Surendran, Dr. D. Srinath.
Thank you all for mobilizing and switching on immediately the video. You are lucky, sir. Of course, yes, sir. I could only interact with only these few people. Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Another ma'am, yeah. Sangeeta Jamal. Yeah. These are the people who are really closely working on along with every resource person.
That's great.
Today,
that's...
But I could see faces only today, despite 4 days FDP was going on. I thought Lakshmi ma'am, the speed in which she was working, I thought she's very young. But I thought you are a professor ma'am. And really, I appreciate your dedication. And she was closely working with me. And she got stuck at some point while I was dealing with CNN when she was telling, I will do that in the evening and let get back. So the dedication really thankful. Thank you, ma'am. We are blessed to have you here amidst the other participants, so that at least we could able to work with closely. You are able to work with all the resource persons.
So that's great. So what are some of the topics that have been covered so far?
In deep learning part. CNNs were covered, RNN was covered.
That's great. So, till now we have 45 participants.
Yeah, we can start. Let me take the pleasure in introducing our chief guest, our resource person of the day, Professor Chandramani Sharma. He has more than a decade of experience in industry, entrepreneurship, research and academia. He is now associated with IIT Delhi as an Institute of Eminence doctoral fellow and as a visiting researcher at McMaster University, Canada. At IIT Delhi, Chandramani is working in the interdisciplinary areas of AI, psychiatry, and neuroscience, and also incubating an IIT Delhi partnership startup, Joy Is You, as a CTO in the mental well-being space with Professor V. Raghavan. He has been the co-founder and ex-director at CDD Global Solutions Limited Liability Firm, worked with many other prestigious organizations such as UPS, Dehradun, Viscom Incorporation, etc. He is working as a consultant with the Plaksha University and Erudus Incorporation. He is co-delivering a certification course on design thinking and innovation being jointly offered by CEP, IIT Delhi, and Erudicious. He has conducted many short-term courses and workshops on AI, data science, and machine learning at various eminent institutions, including IIT Delhi, NIT Patna, Central University of Tamil Nadu, GGB Chhattisgarh, University of Allahabad, Central University of Jharkhand, Banasthali Vidyapeeth, with Dubai, PTU, Jalandhar at Atal Academy. He has been associated with All India Radio as an SME and a speaker on the two programs, Aane Wala Kal in Hindi and Welcome Tomorrow in English. These programs were broadcasted from around 120 Akashwani radio stations across the country. He has convened three successful international hackathons with academia and industry collaborations such as IBM, STPI, Cardiff University, Intel, etc. His areas of interest include healthcare informatics, machine learning, multimodal data processing, human behavior analytics, and human-centered design. He has published many research papers, books, and articles with reputed publishers. He loves reading, writing, and networking with people. With this short note, I indeed once again had the pleasure in introducing you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful introduction. I don't know whether I will kind of live up to the expectations of audience. So thank you so much. Very good afternoon.
Yes, sir.
Very good afternoon, all of you. And it's a pleasure to connect with the Central University of Tamil Nadu. So this is my third Atal FDP. I'm interacting with wonderful audience. Thanks to Professor Chandramouli sir for being so generous, for inviting me over and again. We'll be, in next 2 hours, we'll be talking about some of the aspects of deep learning. Some of the topics that have been discussed and you would be aware of would have got a kind of hands-on exposure to some of the things. And you would have understood the basic ecosystem of a deep learning or machine learning, kind of development or training environment. And today, whatever we discuss, we'll try to keep it as a kind of code walkthrough or kind of hands-on experience so that we will not discuss some rocket science, some very, kind of complex things. But we will discuss some of the very basic things, and there will be just 20, 30 or 50 lines of code that we'll be discussing, but we'll be covering some of the things like what is transfer learning, how is it beneficial, how is it can solve the problems from computer vision. We'll be talking about a little bit about something that is called AutoML, means how to search for the best neural network architecture. So we'll be talking about AutoKeras, which is a library that can automate the task of creating neural networks. We'll be talking a little bit about autoencoders, because this is something which is, this is just a buzzword in the deep learning. It can be used for different applications, ranging from image compression to image generation. There are variational autoencoders, convolutional autoencoders. And deep learning in itself has become a discipline and a kind of, a standalone subject in itself. It has so many things that cannot be covered, within a session or two. So entire kind of, a kind of course that can be delivered across months will cover each and everything. And the library that we'll be using today is Keras. So I think the experiments that you would have done for CNN and other things, you would have used Keras or some other library, PyTorch or?
No, sir, Keras one.
Okay. So, you understand what Keras is and how to write a simple code using Keras with the, kind of freely available tool that is called Google Colab. But there are other ways. If you want to train a deep learning model, then you can set up your local machine, or you can opt some, cloud service providers like Google or Amazon. So to get started with, this thing. So can anybody tell me that what is the difference between machine learning and deep learning, and how is it beneficial, or what limitations does it have? Yes, Professor Lakshmi.
Deep learning actually automatically that is extract the futures. Machine learning we need to do it separately. That is the one difference I identified. Sir.
Okay, very well said by Professor Lakshmi. Can anyone tell me that why do we need feature extraction or what are the features? Yes. Yes, anyone else?
Classification, sir, or prediction?
Yeah, who is that?
Rajkumar.
Okay, Rajkumar, yeah. For classification and for?
Prediction, sir.
Predictions. We require features. But yes. What are the features? If we talk about an image, what can be the features of an image?
It depends, sir. We can take movements formulas we have, no? The low mean standard deviation movement. That we can use.
Yeah.
Later we can go for local feature we can extract. Like that, many features are there, color, shape, and so on.
Yeah. So there are different types of features. And, if we talk about computers in general, and if you want to process data, then computers cannot recognize anything except, digits. So the computers are able to recognize only the binary numbers. That's why whatever is the data, we need to convert that into some binary representation. And there is some limitation with the, any machine learning or any deep learning, technique, because it can work only on numbers. So when you are, processing some text, you cannot directly process the text. It needs to be converted into some numerical representation. There are different ways for representing some textual information into numerical representation. You have bag of words representation. You can have character level encoding, word level encoding called as the embeddings. If you want to process the speech data or some audio data, so that has also to be converted into some numerical representation. If you want to process images or videos or ECG signals or EEG signals, you cannot process them directly unless and until they are represented in the form of numerical data. So that's why we need to have this conversion. And if you want to process images, so there is a limitation with the traditional machine learning algorithms like decision trees, support vector machines, KNN, logistic regression. So there are limitations with these algorithms because they cannot directly process the images unless and until you convert them into some numerical representations. That's why first you need to extract the features. They may be in the form of local binary patterns or hue movements or some spatiotemporal aspects of the image, and then you can apply a classifier. But there is an advantage with deep learning that you can actually have an end-to-end learning. So end-to-end learning means that there is no explicit feature extraction step. You just input your images and the features are automatically extracted and you can apply the classifier. So how the features are extracted automatically? So there are certain operations that you would have come across, like you can apply convolutional operations, you can apply a kind of pooling operations, you can apply different other operations. So they can automatically extract the features, they can distill the information so that one class of images can be discriminated or can be distinguished from other classes of the images. So that is the basic advantage of using deep learning. Like if you are applying it for image classification, then it becomes end-to-end. Okay. So and there are different models available for deep learning. There are pre-trained architectures available, because when we talk about deep learning, then the data denomination needs to be tens of thousands. So unless and until you do not have the data in the form of 1 lakh, 2 lakh samples, you cannot train a very, you know, good classifier that is generalized and does not overfit or underfit. But you can also work with the limited amount of data. There are models that can be trained using one-shot learning, few-shot learning. You can apply, transfer learning ways by which you can utilize and reuse already acquired knowledge. So we'll be talking about transfer learning today. We'll be seeing that how to apply transfer learning on a very basic problem, having few thousand images. And before that, because you already understand Keras, you already understand how to work with Colab, you already understand how to create a simple a CNN model, how to import layers and then models, how to stack up the layers and how to train a classifier. So all of you would have, seen that in previous sessions. Am I right? Okay, so let's start in the chat window. I have shared with you one, my drives link. So there are some resources available in the form of Jupyter notebooks. What you need to do, you need to just select all these files and just download them on your local system. So that is step number one. So I've shared it in the edit mode. Do not cut and paste it. You are requested not to cut and paste it or create a copy of that at the same location. What you need to do, you just need to select all the files, right click, and you will get a download option. So these files will get downloaded to your local file. And in next step, in your Google Drive, make any folder and just upload these files to your drive, and rest of the things we can, walk together in the lines of code and what these files are all about. So is it clear? Let me share my screen.
Yes, sir.
Okay, hope my screen is visible to you. Yeah, so this is the drive, this is the folder that I shared with you. And these are some of the, files. So it contains copy of autoencoder, AutoML, and, different topics. So let's see that how many of them we covered today. And you just need to select all of these files and just need to right click, and then you'll get an option to download. So these files will get downloaded to your local file system. And what you need to do, you just need to create any folder in your drive. So this is drive, you can right click and create a folder. And in that folder, you need to upload these files. So whenever, if you want to, upload these files, so select all these files and just drag and drop in your newly created folder, or you can get an option of uploading files. So from here, you can choose the location where you have downloaded the files, and these codes will be available in your Google Drive, right? So I think that each one of you understand that how to work with Google Colab, what it is, and what is .ipynb file. So if you do not understand that, or if you have any confusion, you may ask. But let's get started with something called as AutoML. So there will be a file called as copy of AutoML. So this IPyNB, which is interactive Python notebook. So that is just a Jupyter notebook extension. You can open these files in a browser. If you are having Anaconda installed on your system, or you can directly double click on this if you have worked with this Colab. Otherwise, you can right click and look for this Google Colab. If you are using Google Colab first time, then you need to, you know, click here, connect more apps, and then you need to search Colab from here, from the Google Workspace Marketplace. Just type Colab and you will get it like this. And it is already installed. Otherwise, there will be an option of installing it in your drive. So once that is done, so you can just open this particular file, open with Google Colab, or just double click. If it is the default version of the default application available in your system, right? So can anybody tell me that what is Auto Keras? Have you used it before? Or what is the concept of Auto ML? Yes. Are you aware of this concept of Auto ML?
शाम की मीटिंग के बारे में मुझे लगा कुछ बात भी है क्या
Yes, please mute. We are not talking about evening's meeting. Yeah, are you aware of this concept of neural grid search or Auto ML, automatic machine learning, Auto Keras? Okay, if you are not aware, then let's discuss. So by this time, what type of neural networks you have developed, like you have created some, there is a problem, like there are three types of flowers, iris flower, a data set is available, and you want to create a classifier, and you want to create a neural network architecture that gives you the best accuracy and the least loss. So you basically try to, optimize these two parameters. Like there should be the, best classification accuracy, and there should be least, loss. So that is how a typical neural network optimization works. But what is the way to solve any problem? Like you define some random architecture, or you look at the previously solved, problems, and you try to apply that model. Either you are developing from scratch, or there are some developed models that you're using. And then you'll see that how well they are able to solve your problems. Maybe one model may not work, then you will try the other model, and then you will keep on, doing a kind of, search for the best model. But this task can be automated, and there are tools and techniques for doing this. And in Keras ecosystem, there is a API called as Auto Keras that can help you found the best neural network architecture. So it can search for a number of architectures, maybe 15, 20 or 1,000 based on the parameter value that you provide. And it will test all those architectures, and it will give you the best architecture possible. So this is our Google Colab workspace. So there are two types of cells available in this particular sheet. Either you can have code or text. And if you want to install some package that is not available with the Keras's default installation, then you can install it with the help of pip install auto Keras. And you need to just keep this mark of exclamation. So this is equivalent to executing this command on your local system. So if you're using Anaconda packet manager or PIP package manager, then you can you would be aware of this particular command. So here what we are doing, we are installing this Auto Keras, which is a library that we'll be using for searching for the best neural network architecture for solving our problem. And the data set that we'll be using for solving this particular problem is Sonar data set. So that is just a binary, two class data set. And There are some samples, so we'll be talking about this. So it is downloading this auto Keras, and it will be installed on your local, on your, you know, this instance of Colab. Yeah, it is a library. It will take some time. It is dependent on TensorFlow, and that's why it is updating TensorFlow as well. Okay, so once its installation is finished, then what we can do, we can just see whether it is installed or not. Okay, its installation is there, and with this auto Keras, we'll be installing one Keras tuner. So that is just a, you know, tuning library by which we can optimize the different architectures, that different models that it will be searching. So it will take some time to install it. And once it is done, then we'll be seeing that how to use it for finding out, for automating the task of finding out the best possible architecture out of the available, you know, instances. So it is just like, you know, creating a kind of random forest from the available decision trees. And it is just an optimization of different neural networks available that we call as the candidate networks. And it will be, yes. And it will be, you know, kind of creating different architectures, and we'll be testing them on this sonar data set. So this particular data set is, you know, having two classes, and there are two target labels, zero and one. So zero refers to rock and mine. So this particular data set has been created in this way. So it is a very small data set. It consists of 208 rows, but there are 60, you know, features or columns in this particular data set. So getting a good accuracy is not that easy, because the number of samples is very limited, is very less, just 208 rows. And the number of features are very, very, you know, compared in comparison with the number of rows. So there are 60 columns and 208 rows. So this is just a kind of, you know, one benchmarking data set that can be used to test any architecture or on binary classification. So let's import some of these packages, and let's import this data set as well. So this data set is very, you know, popular, and it can be downloaded. Yeah, what is the problem? Okay, we need to restart the runtime. Okay, let's see. Yeah, everything goes well. Why is it not able to load this auto Keras structured? does not currently take into account all the packages that are installed. The behavior is in source of the following difficulties, requires NumPy, but you have NumPy 1.18.5, which is incompatible data science. Okay, so there is some, you know, inconsistency in the packages. So let's just see that how this auto Keras library, you know, works. So these are the different packages that we need to import. We need to import NumPy and the pandas, sklearn.model selection. So we'll be doing train test split, and from pre-processing we'll be using this label encoder. And this is the most important you know, class that we'll be requiring. So it is a structured data classifier. And this particular method basically looks for different neural network architectures that can best, you know, classify this particular data set. So the data set is available at different sources. You can download it from UCI repository, or it is available from this particular, you know, repository, which is sonar.csv. So this is available in the form of CSV file. And with the help of this pandas function read underscore CSV, you are loading this data set. So you are providing URL and header is none. It is not having first row as the, you know, headers. So it is not containing any header. That's why you need to pass it as none. And you can just see that what are the shape of this data set. So there are 208 rows and 80 columns. And what you are doing next, you are splitting it into training and, you know, in X and Ys. So X represents the features and Y represents the class levels. So what we are doing here, we are just dividing into two parts, X and Y. So minus one always refers to the last column in a, you know, in a NumPy array. So this is how the indexing is done. So minus one always refers to the last element. So what we are doing, this is the number of rows and this is the column. So we are, you know, fetching all rows and all columns, but we are skipping the last one. So all the 59, you know, columns, which are the X values or the features, will be placed inside this variable X. And the last column, because we are using here minus one. So minus one refers the last one, last element. So last column will be placed in this variable Y. And then we can print it. So it should print the shape of the data set, like what are the, you know, X and Y. So there are 208 rows in X and there are 59 columns coming here. And there is just one column in this Y and 208 rows in this Y. And what we are doing, we are just trying to, you know, trying to fit this transform where we'll be applying label encoder, and it will be encoding that in the form of, you know, some binary representation. And it will be a two element array for each of the labels. So wherever it is zero, so wherever it is class one, that that particular, the first element will be placed as one and second will be placed as zero. And wherever it is another class, then it will be keeping the first element as zero and the other element as one. So this is how this label encoder works. And what we are doing next, we are using this train test split function that we have imported from model selection, you know, package, which is available as part of sklearn library. So for using traditional approaches, we have this sklearn, scikit-learn, machine learning library that has many important functions for training and for doing various stuff, including this train underscore test underscore split. So we have this X and Y, and the test size is 0.33. So 33% of the data will be using for testing. And we want to make the results reproducible. and that's why we are using this random state as one. Otherwise, the result will be a kind of kind of unpredictable every time. So for one instance, you may get something. For other instance of running this code, you will get some other results. But to make them reproducible, we are using this random underscore state, and you can use the random.seed function from NumPy to make them more predictable. And then you are printing the shape of this X train and X test and Y train and Y test. And what is the most important thing to understand with this particular line of code? So here we are using automatic neural network search, and there is a function that is a structured data classifier, and that can create 15 different architectures, 15 different neural network architectures, and that we specify with the help of this parameter called as max underscore trials. So how many instances we want to evaluate, how many candidates we want to evaluate, that you can pass with the help of this. So it is max underscore trials. And what you can do, so this is the mass best architecture that you have, the 15 different candidates that you have created. And then you'll be using this particular fit function to train the best to train the different candidates. And for that you just pass the X value and Y value, and you want to keep the outcome of the training as silent. So that's why you are keeping this verbose equals to zero. And then you can evaluate the model that what accuracies it gave. And that can be done with the help of evaluate function, calling evaluate function and passing the X and Ys of test data. And again, you are keeping this output as silent. So then you can print that what is the accuracy of this model, and you can see the prediction based on the values, because for prediction you need to pass these 59 features, and then you will get the prediction. So we have taken here some dummy features. So these are the 59 features, and then you can pass them, and you can predict that what is the label corresponding to that. And if you want to export it, then you can export the model and can later on use it. So I wanted to basically run this model, but due to the incompatibility of these libraries, this could not be executed for the time being, but you can try this and can see how this incompatibility can be resolved as of now, because it is updated to the latest Keras with this updation. And it was executed few months back. It was running fine, but this time, due to this incompatibility, it is not executed. But to give you an idea that what AutoML is, how it can be applied. So there are two libraries. One is this Auto Keras, and then there is Keras Tuner that can be used to generate some of the candidate samples, some of the candidate architectures, and that you can evaluate on your data. So this is one small topic that I wanted to discuss. And the next thing that I want to discuss is to use autoencoder. So are you aware of this concept of autoencoder? What is an autoencoder? Okay, so I think some of the people have joined late. Have you got the link for this drive? I'm sharing it again. Yeah, so I have shared it again. So we discussed one concept, that is auto ML. It means automatically creating some of the instances for solving a given problem, and we use two libraries, Keras Tuner, so that is basically for tuning the model, and Auto Keras, so that can be combined with this Keras library, and it is dependent on TensorFlow and Keras. Now we'll be talking about something that is called as auto encoder, and there are different types of auto encoders. Like there is convolutional autoencoders, variational autoencoders. So what is basically an autoencoder? So here we'll be using an autoencoder to compress the image data. So what basically autoencoder means? Auto and encoder. It means you are encoding something. Suppose there is some image and you want to encode it. It means you want to understand that how it is formed. And you may use it, use the autoencoders for regenerating the data. So they can be used at the generative models. They can be used to compress the data because you understand that how an image is being formed, and you can reduce the size it requires to be stored. And there are different other ways, like you can use an autoencoder as a noise reducing filter or noise reducing, denoising mechanism. So let's see that what an autoencoder is. So here we'll be creating an autoencoder, and an autoencoder is just a neural network. So this is just a neural network architecture. And what we are doing here, we'll be compressing an image. So whatever input data you have, so the encoding dimension is 32 and the original dimension is 784. So we'll be converting the data that comes in the dimension of 784. So this is the size of the data, to a dimension of 32. So we'll be kind of compressing it. And if you convert 784 to 32, so you are basically downsampling the data. So it gives you a compression of 24/5. So we'll be compressing the data with this, kind of scale of factor. So an autoencoder is a simple neural network, but it is slightly different because it encodes itself. So instead of, taking some input and producing some output, what you'll do, you will just create X out of X, and the new X will be this much of compressed. So let's see that how to create a simple autoencoder. So we'll be defining an input image, and the input shape is 784, and we are creating one encoded layer. So what we are doing, we are just creating one dense layer. So this is how neural networks are defined, and we are using Keras library. So we have imported these two packages. So from Keras we are importing this layers module, and inside layers we have this dense layer. So dense layer, you just need to define that how many neurons you want to keep and what is the activation that you want to apply, and what is the input to this particular layer. So we have defined one input, so that will be in the in the form of dimension of 784. So it may be in the form of 28/28/1, but you have collectively defined it, in this way. So, yeah. And then you are defining this layer. So it is the encoding dimension. The encoding dimension is 32, so it means the output of this particular layer will be 32, and the activation is ReLU. And then we are defining one decoded layer, and again we are creating one dense layer, and it will decode it in this particular, the output of this layer will be 784, and activation is sigmoid in this case, and we are passing encoded data to this particular layer. So it is just a kind of compression decompression mechanism. You are converting 784 to 32, and you are converting 32 to 784. So this is just a kind of reconstruction mechanism, and these two layers define encoding and decoding mechanism, and it is collectively called as auto encoder, because you are first encoding and then you are decoding the data. And what we are doing will be using some image data, and we'll be compressing it, and we'll be seeing that how the compressed and recreated images look like. So we'll be working on image data set, and we'll be compressing the image data set, and we'll be uncompressing the image data set, and we'll be seeing that how the 24.5 factors compressed images look like. And then what we are creating, we are just defining one model by using this Keras dot model. So there are two types of APIs available with Keras. One is sequential API and another one is functional API. So is there any difference between functional and sequential API that Keras provides? I think in your CNN example, you would have used this Keras.sequential API for creating model. Yes, are you aware of sequential and functional API? Okay, so this is model gives you a functional API, and you can define and create different types of models, like you can provide multiple inputs to a neural network. You can even produce multiple outputs, and you can connect into kind of non-linear way. But with the help of sequential API, you can just stack up layers one on the top of other. And so this is our auto encoder. What is auto encoder? In auto encoder, there are just two layers. One layer encodes the data and another layer decodes the data. So we are encoding the data. So what the encoding layer does, that it will take 784 sized data. So that is basically a digit in the form of 28 by 28 by 1. And it will compress that particular data into 32. So the compression ratio will be 24.5. And this is just a simple neural network model, but it is being used for compression. Okay, so let's execute this code. Okay, and here, as you would have seen, that whenever we define our model, then in next step we need to compile it. And whenever we compile, then apart from other parameters, there are many optional parameters, but there are two kind of mandatory or essential parameters. One is optimizer and another one is loss. So this is how the learning happens. Because whenever you provide some samples to the network, then it will compare that what the output should be and what the output is. So it will compare the expected and the actual outputs, and based on that comparison and based on some loss function, it will calculate that what is the loss, how much error is there in the output, and that error needs to be kind of back propagated so that you can optimize the weights of the weights in the network. And for optimization, you have different kind of optimizers. So here we are using Adam optimizer, that is recent and very frequently used, and there are other optimizers as well that can use for this, like RMS prop. There is NADM, Ada Delta. So there are different optimizers that you can use here. And let's compile it. Once you compile it, then you can see the summary of the model that you have just created. And this is the very basic network. What we are doing here, we are passing input that is in the form of 784. So this is the dimension of 28 by 28 by 1 for the digits data set that we'll be using. And then it is converting it into a compressed representation that is 32, and again will be outputting the same data. We'll be reconstructing the images after compression. So this is autoencoder. So autoencoder, basically you work on X, you transform it and you try to get X. So this is the basic mechanism, and there are different purposes for which autoencoders are used. You can use them as a compression mechanism because you are able to reconstruct the original image, because you are, you may use it as a transmission mechanism. You are transmitting it in a server, in a network, and then you are downloading it, and again you are reconstructing the image based on this compressed image. So its architecture is very simple. You are inputting this, you are compressing it, and you are able to get the original image. So after seeing the actual and the compressed data and reconstructing from the data, you can see that how well it did from your eyes only. And what we are doing, we will be applying this compression on a data set called as MNIST. So that is a digits data set, and the data is available in the form of zipped compressed NumPy arrays, and that is in the form of 28 by 28 cross 1. So there is just one channel because it is just a grayscale data set. And we are importing this NumPy package. What we are doing, we are loading this data set. So whenever we load this data set, so it automatically divides into training and test data. So the second one is we have kept just, you can provide the name of this. So it contains the label, and it contains the data, and it can be loaded with the help of this load underscore data function. So that is a generic function. There are different types of data sets available in Keras data set. There is MNIST, there is CIFAR, there is IMDB. Okay, so there are different data sets available so that you can very conveniently work with these data sets. And what we are doing some sort of transformations and normalizations on the data set, because neural networks can learn from the small values. So if you keep the values in the range of 0 to 1, so the learning will be better, because the neural networks work on, kind of optimization that can work on the smaller values. So there are, this data set is there. So it is a grayscale data set. Either it will have, black or white pixels, but you want to convert it into instead of keeping in this range up to 255, you want to rescale it in the range of 0 to 1. So a pixel can have maximum intensity value of 255. So what we are doing, we are dividing every, you know, value, every pixel value with the 255, and it will be automatically converted into 0 and 1. So we are dividing this and 255 dots. So it is just, you know, writing 255 dot and 0. So there is no need to write 0 after, you know, dot. So it will be automatically float. And this float conversion is done, and scaling is done in the range of 0 to 1. And so it is done both for testing and, you know, training data set that we have just, you know, divided into two parts. So whenever we are loading this data set, it automatically, you know, converts into this. And what we are doing, we are just reshaping it. So as this data set contains, so there are 60,000 samples for our training, and there are 10,000 samples for testing. So this is the standard dimension of data set, but it is in the form of, you know, it is just in the very crude form, NumPy compressed, you know, formats, but you want to reshape so that you can display that in the form of images. So we are reshaping it, and there are 60,000 samples that will be using for training, and there are 10,000 samples that will be using for testing that how well it performed. And then just like any other model, any other neural network model, after compiling and after, you know, pre-processing your data, we need to fit. So fit is used for training. So the actual machine learning, neural network based training will happen here. And here we need to pass a couple of, you know, parameters like this X, train, and this. Yes. So what we are doing, we are just reconstructing the image. So whatever you are passing, you will be just testing it against the same sample, and we'll be using the number of epochs. So epochs are just the iterations for which you want to perform training. And instead of sending the entire data set in one go, that is not you know, computationally feasible. So instead of passing the entire data set in one go, you can divide them into you know, mini groups, that is called batches. So here we are keeping the batch size of 256 images, and the shuffling is true. And for validation, we are keeping the same X and X, and it will be performing training and will be monitoring the loss and loss that how well this reconstruction is, because here we are not using it for classification. We are using as an autoencoder. So in classification, we provide, you know, the data, the features, and the class level, but here we are not providing any class levels, and we are using the same, you know, X train and X test and in both the places. And instead of, you know, providing accuracy, because there is no accuracy, there is just, you know, kind of loss that how well it reconstructed the image. And when you train a model in some classification problem, then instead of getting, you know, loss, you apart from getting loss, you also get accuracy. But here we are just monitoring the loss, and let's see that whether it is improving as the number of epochs. So we have used here 50 epochs, and training has finished, and we have, you know, got this loss of 0.926. So that is a very, you know, a kind of least loss, and with the every passing epoch, it is reducing. So when it is reducing, it means that it is learning from the data. So it is started with, you know, as high as 0.27, and it kept on reducing with the passes of every epoch. So after, at the end of 50th epoch, you can see that it is reduced to 0.09. So if you can, if you want to further reduce it, so you can train it for more number of epochs and can see that how well it performed. So once our autoencoder is trained, and autoencoder is just an X to X mapping. So you are having some data X, and you are compressing it, and you are able to reconstruct it. Because if you have compressed it, and you have a mechanism to reconstruct from the compressed image, so that will be good, and that may have various, you know, applications. And that's how different you know, compression algorithms here, like JPEG and others work. And let's see that how the compressed and reconstructed images look like. Are they same, or is there very you know, very big difference? So let's see that how this model will perform. So this is the original, you know, data. So these are the images that are in the original data, and we have compressed it and we are reconstructing it. So here you can see that there is some loss of, you know, kind of data after reconstruction. Like 7, there is some, you know, it has got blurred, but still if you pass it to any image classifier, it will be able to recognize it without any problem. And even, you know, human eye can recognize. Like in 9, there may be some, you know, big loss. In 5, there is some loss, but in rest of the images, we are able to reconstruct from the compressed data. So this is autoencoder, and an example of how to use autoencoders for image construction and reconstructing the original data from the compressed images. And what is an autoencoder? Autoencoder is a simple neural network where you you know, do transformation on X. Instead of working on the class levels, you just try to create recreate the original you know, input from the transformed you know, data only. And it may be used as a denoising filter or as a denoising mechanism. Even you can create new samples. So there are generative adversarial networks or variational autoencoders that can be used as a kind of, you know, generative mechanisms. Like if you want to create new samples from the data, then you can use it in the form of variational autoencoders as well. Right. Any questions so far? Okay, so.
Sir, can we use this autoencoder in image data as well? Means that is medical image data as well, whether it will be useful to reconstruct and that is remove noise in there?
Yes, yes, yes. It is very much in use to kind of, you know, denoise images. Like there are, you know, some chest X-ray images, and you find that there are some, you know, noise on the data. So you can create one encoder mechanism, and then you can try to eliminate noise from that. And for that, variational autoencoder mechanism can also be used. And there is an example for variational autoencoder as well, VAE. Like you can create even some unseen samples as well, because it happens that your data is limited, and it happens when, you know, you are dealing with some rare disease, and there are some, you know, rare cancerous images that are just, there is an imbalance of 1:1,000, and you want to create new samples. So you can use variational autoencoder and can see it. So there are examples around this variational autoencoder as well. And It has been used to create new samples. So it has been used on this, RGB image data set. And these samples are the newly created samples. So these are the randomly created samples. So here you can see that it has created some of the threes and some of the sevens and some of the ones. And how it has created them, because it has understood that how the statistical parameters like there are two standard parameters that are used here by which a data set can be represented. So this is z underscore mean and z log sigma. So by learning these two parameters, you can create new samples. So it has two, three applications. The first one is that you can use it as a denoising mechanism. Another application is if you want to create some samples, okay, from the data itself. Like it has been used in many ways to create the hypothetical or kind of imaginary human faces. So the human faces have been created that have never been existed. So it will randomly, it will take some of the face images and it will create some random face image that you cannot, kind of recognize. So there are many applications that, like, there is a small, one application, I don't know whether you would have seen, most probably you would have seen, that you just upload an image and there is in the background, there is some, song, and automatically the lip sync is done on that static image only. So when you are capturing your photo and there is a model, so that will generate your images while create new images or even new video while you are singing or performing some act. So it is something new, but there are certain concerns. There are certain ethical concerns as well, because you are able to create some of the things like you are not singing, but still it is creating something that you are singing, or it is able to create a new profile and creating a new person. So you may use that image, but the person is not existing. So it is very interesting, and it depends on that how you want to use it. So this is something that I wanted to discuss. And now let's move to something which is very interesting and maybe very useful, that is transfer learning and fine tuning. So let's switch to that. And there are many files available here, so we don't have time to discuss each and everything, like NLP Keras, that you would have already got to learn something about how to use RNN and different recurrent architectures like LSTM GRU for natural language processing tasks. And so let's move to something that is called transfer learning. Okay, so we'll be working on this very simple problem, that is the cats and dogs classification. And this particular problem, kind of presented as part of one competition in 2013 or 14. But it is very complex problem, because sometimes the dogs and cats, images are so closely, closely similar that it is difficult to discriminate for the human beings whether it belongs to a dog or it belongs to a cat. But this particular data set is there, and this is a very big data set. It has 25,000 images of dogs and cats belonging to two different categories. There is validation data set available separately, and there is training data set available. But we'll be seeing that how to train a classifier with the help of transfer learning and with the help of some concept called as fine tuning. So inside transfer learning, there is a concept called as fine tuning. So what basically transfer learning means that you are transferring something. So some knowledge that you have already, you know, acquired, and you want to learn or you want to solve some problem, but that is not exactly the same problem that for which you have acquired the knowledge. Suppose you, if you want to, you know, want to ride a gearless scooter or kind of Activa, okay, but you just know how to ride a bicycle. So for the people who already know how to ride a bicycle, it will be easier to ride a gearless scooter, because some of the things, some of the training that you have got during, you know, during riding the bicycle, that may be helpful to solve this problem or to get training on this new problem, that is to ride a gearless scooter. So transfer learning works in the same way. So there are many deep learning architectures that have been trained on thousands of categories of objects, thousands categories of objects, and millions or lakhs of samples. So for object classification, there is a very, you know, very big data set that we call as ImageNet data set, and that contains lakhs of images, and there are 1,000 categories of objects. So you name any object and its class is available, because the 1,000 categories, the ranging from the household items to the different animals classes and all. So it contains those things, but it was not trained on cats and dogs. It did not have these two categories, and we'll see that whether it can be used to discriminate these two classes. And let's get started. So we are installing some of the packages. We are installing this TQDM, which is just a process visualization tool. Like whenever some data processing is happening, so it will just visualize that data processing. So it does not have very kind of serious use, but it will be good. Like whenever we are downloading data or whenever training is happening, it will present a kind of progress bar. And we are importing these two packages OS. So we'll be performing some of the operating system level functions. And the data set would be downloaded into our drive somewhere. And we'll be using just a part of data set. So this cats and dogs data, original data set contains 25,000 images, but instead of performing training on that big of data, and these are RGB images. So it is very large in size, so it will not be possible to train it, because it will consume many minutes or hours of training. So we'll be using a subset of this data set, and that will contain 3,000 images. So we'll be using 2,000 images for training, and we'll be using 1,000 images for testing, and we'll be seeing that how well it performed. And next one is we are mounting this drive, because when the data is available on your local on your Google Drive, and you want to allow some colab file to access your drive, then you need to provide it an explicit permission. So it will just ask whether you want to provide it permission or not. So I want to allow it. And it is mounted to this particular location. So this is content and drive, and inside that there is my drive root location, and from there your drive starts. So I want to move to a location that is this particular folder. So wherever I'm working, I need to move to that particular drive. So I have mounted to this particular folder. But inside that also, there is a My Drive folder. And inside that, there is CUTN, this folder that I've created. So I want to basically set my route as this particular location. So this is my CUTN folder, and I want to provide, means whatever you know, data I want to download, whatever data I want to access, it should refer to this particular location as the root location. So for that, I'm using this particular function os.chdir, and that is for changing directory. So this is just like cd command that I want to execute, but I cannot directly execute cd command, and I want to change this location in my drive. So that I can do with the help of this, you know, command, that is os.changedirectory, chdir. So and you can see that it is still pointing to this content location, but I'm not able to access my actual folder in my drive. So I need to do this os.chdir. So I am here in this location. And since you'll be executing this a very first time, so what you need to do, you need to download this data set. So this particular, you know, data set can be downloaded with this wget command. And once you execute this, so what will it do? It will just download this particular cats underscore dogs filtered dot zip file in your drive. So I have executed this, it is already there in my drive, but if you are executing it along with me, then you need to execute you know, this particular code, and it will download this particular, you know, data in your drive. So it is just 65.43 you know, MB in size, and it contains 3000 images. So it is in the compressed format, that's why its size note is not that big. But the entire data set would be of around you know, 500 MB. If you want to work with 25,000 images, so you can work on that. But we are just working on a subset of that particular data set, and there are just 2000 images. So I will not execute this particular line of code because it is already downloaded in my drive. So it will be redundant to download it again. And what we are doing, we'll be doing some sort of data processing. And from here, you can understand that how you can, you know, flow the data from your local file system or from Google Drive. So there is some mechanism that is called image data generators that can help you to get your data from your local, you know, drive system or from Google Drive. And we are importing these packages. We are importing this zip file package because we'll be uncompressing this data with the help of this particular, you know, zip file API. And TensorFlow, and for visualization, we are using this matplot library. And TQDM is for process visualization. So we are importing this TQDM, but it does not have any, you know, any essential use here in this case. And the most important thing to understand is how to use image data generators, because if you want to train some image classifiers, if you want to work on image data sets, whether belonging to healthcare domain or whatever type of classifiers you want to perform, then you need to understand the working of these image data generators. And these are very, you know, powerful. They come with many, many hyperparameters. Like if you want to do some sort of augmentation, or you want to do some sort of scaling, rescaling, normalization. So there are different, you know, hyperparameters that you can use with the with image data to improve the accuracy of your model. Because if you use you know, data augmentation, then definitely you will be able to add some more samples, and it will help you to generalize your deep learning model. So we'll see that how to use image data generator, and which is the package from where we can find this particular class. So that is inside tensorflow.keras.preprocessing.image. So Keras can be, you know, imported in two ways and can be accessed in two ways. It can be accessed as a standalone package, like you can directly import Keras and it is also a part of TensorFlow. So when you import it from, you know, TensorFlow, then it gives you some extra functions. Like when you want to compile your model and you want to have access to some optimizer and you want to tweak some parameter, suppose learning rate. So from Keras, you cannot, you have access to, you know, optimizers, but there you cannot get access to the learning rate. But if you want to modify learning rate, then you need to access it from tensorflow.keras. So we are importing it in that way because you get some more hyperparameters to tune. And yeah, so we have executed this and we are unzipping this dogs and cats data set. So once you download it, then it will be in the form of cats and dogs, dot gif file, but you want to unzip it. So one of the simplest ways to download it and to, you know, uncompress it and again, you know, upload it, or other ways that you can use this this gif file API, and that can help you to uncompress it in your drive itself. So we are, you know, having this data path as dot cats and dogs filtered dot gif. So this is the name of the file which is existing in our current working directory, the dot, and you are creating a gif object of this particular, you know, class. So this is again you know, one class available in this module, and the file is data set path, and you want to you know, read it, you want to access in the read mode, and from there there is extract all you know, function. So it will just do a kind of uncompression, and it will unzip the file, and you will have to close this particular zip object, and these lines are just to uncompress the data that you have just downloaded. But if you want to unzip it in some other way, so this code will not be required, but you need to execute each and every cell so that the things get automated. And since this data set is already unzipped in my you know, drive, so this is available cats and dogs filtered. So this folder is unzipped and this is the zipped folder. And from here, you can see that there are two subfolders created. One is for training and another one is for validation. So this training data, training folder again contains two folders, cats and dogs. So inside cats, there are images of cats. And inside dogs, there are images of dogs. Right, so it is already, you know, available. It is already uncompressed. So I will not again uncompress it. And next, what we can do, okay, next thing is that we'll be setting up the data set paths. So now we'll be creating image data generators, and we'll be flowing the data set from our Google Drive, and here we will be applying transfer learning. So transfer learning is that we will not create our own network architecture, like creating a stack of convolutional layers and then pooling and then convolutional layers and then flatten and then one output layer. So what we'll do here, we will use the weights of some pre-trained model. So that is the transfer learning all about, that how to use some pre-trained model and how to use its, you know, its weights. So here we'll be using one deep learning architecture, that is MobileNet V2. There are different deep learning architectures available, and depending on the complexity of the problem. So there are recent ones, there are, you know, kind of old ones. And these deep learning architectures are generally, you know, ranging from few hundred MBs to GBs, because their weights are very, very large. So you can pick up anyone, and MobileNet V2 is a very popular architecture, and it can give you a very good performance on almost all the tasks, whether it is binary classification problem, multi-class classification problem. And this particular architecture has been trained on a very large scale image data set called as ImageNet. There are other deep learning architectures like VGG16, VGG19, ResNet, and other architectures, Exception, Inception. So you can use any of these deep learning architectures, and the basic process will be same. You just need to keep in mind a couple of things that we'll be discussing, that what are the some of the important things that you need to keep into your mind so that you can reuse them. So dataset.path, so we have specified where our dataset lies. So it is available in cats and dogs filtered in the uncompressed form, and we are specifying these training directories and validation directories. So inside that, inside this path, there is train folder and validation folder that contains our training and validation, data sets respectively. Now, what we are doing, we are creating one transfer learning model. So as I, told you that instead of creating a model from scratch, we'll be reusing pre-existing model, and that model is MobileNet V2. So there are many pre-trained models available as part of Keras applications, Keras.applications. So that is the module in which there are many pre-trained deep learning architectures are available. And we are specifying here the input image shape. So we'll be working on this image type 128x128x3. So that is the size of the images that we have in the form of dogs and cats. And we are loading this MobileNet V2 architecture. And we need to specify a couple of things, like what is the input shape that you want to provide an input to this model, whether you want to include the top. So this particular model has been trained to recognize 1,000 categories of images. So it means the last layer will contain 1,000 number of units as a dense layer. So we will not include that layer because we will define our own custom output, because we are working on binary classification problem. So we'll be using just one unit in our last layer instead of keeping it 1,000. So we are keeping include top as false. And we are using the weights of ImageNet because it has been trained on ImageNet architecture. So we need to provide here that which weights we want to use. And once you execute it, then it will start downloading this model. And this is a moderately sized model. If you download some of the recent models, then it may be in many MBs, and it will take some time to download. And it has been downloaded and it has been saved into this variable called as base_model. And what we are going to do next, that here we are using this model as it is. So there are two ways: either you are just applying transfer learning, or you are performing fine tuning. So at the starting, we are not performing any fine tuning. We'll be performing fine tuning at the later section of this code book. So what we are doing, base model dot trainable equals to false. So this trainable is a kind of hyperparameter that can be assigned value true or false. So we are making our entire model as our entire model's trainability as false, right? So there are around 153 layers in this architecture, and we are keeping all the layers. So we are not keeping the last layer, and we are making all the layers as frozen. So we are freezing every layer, and we'll be seeing that how to unfreeze some of the layers. And what we are doing, we are just seeing the output of our, you know, base model, it is in the dimension of 4x4x1280. And we want to use this particular, you know, model for our training. But whenever we want to, you know, create a dense layer, then you would have seen that dense layers can work only on the, you know, the output layer can work only on the linear data. So instead of keeping it 4x4x1280, it just needs to be, you know, 1280. So we need to get rid of this, you know, 4x4, these two dimensions, and we just need to create, we just need to create this output as a linear, you know, kind of output. So what we can do, we just need to do some sort of, you know, kind of downsampling of these features. And for doing this, we want to do it globally. And that's why we need to apply one global average pooling. So you understand that what the pooling works, what is the average pooling, what is max pooling. So instead of working, you know, on the patches, it will take the entire filter and it will perform the pooling for that. So it will take four by four dimensions and it will perform the you know, pooling, and it will return just one value. So instead of keeping this 4x4 into 1280, it will produce an output of just 1280 by taking the, you know, kind of average of this 4x4 you know, sized data. And yeah, so we have created this base model. We have seen this, the output is 1280, but we cannot put our output layer upon this. We need to kind of linearize this in the dimension of 1280. So for that, we are applying this global average pooling, and the three-dimensional output will be converted into just, you know, kind of one-dimensional output. So that is the advantage of global average pooling layer. And yeah, once it is done, then its dimension is changed from 4x4 to 1280 to just 1280. So now this is, you know, something good on which we can add our output layer. So output layer is generally a dense layer, and depending on you, whether it is a multi-class classification problem, how many classes are there, or it is just a binary classification problem, we can keep the number of units accordingly. Like if it is a digit classification problem having 10 different you know, digits classes, then the number of units in the output layer should be 10. But if it is just a binary classification problem, then you can keep the number of units just as one, and can keep the activation function as, you know, sigmoid, and sigmoid can give you you know, output either 0 or 1, you know, because it is 1 plus e raised to power minus x. So its range is 0 or 1. And let's execute this. And what we are doing here, we are making one prediction layer. So what is our prediction layer? So that is the output layer. We are creating one, you know, last layer on the top layer, that is a dense layer that is containing number of units or the neurons in our, you know, the output dimension is 1. And activation is sigmoid in this case, because we are working on binary classification problem. If it would have been multi-class classification problem, so instead of sigmoid, we would have used softmax or some other, you know, activation function. And we are inputting this global average layer. So whatever output was produced in this particular step, here, so we are adding that as the base, and this is our top. So if you want to, you know, combine two layers, the output of one layer or output of one you know, variable as the input to a layer, then it can be done in this way. And this is our output layer, which is also the prediction layer, and it will be used as a binary classifier. So here you can see that what we have done so far, we have loaded MobileNet V2 architecture, which is available inside tensorflow.keras.applications. And because this particular model has been trained on ImageNet data set that contains thousand classes, but our present problem is just a binary classification problem. So we will keep the top as false. We are not loading the top in this model mobile net v2 architecture, and we have defined our custom head where there is just one dense layer and there is just one unit, and activation is sigmoid, and we are combining our base with this particular layer. So this is our custom model that we have created. We have not added much of the layers here. We have just added two layers here. One is global average pooling and another one is a dense layer. Why we added a global average pooling? Because whenever you have applied a series of suppose convolutional operations and then pooling and then others, so at the last, you before dense layer you apply flatten layer, because to the dense layer you can just pass linear input, so that has to be in the one dimension. So that's why we had to apply one dimensional. And in normal convolutional or convnet architectures, we apply flatten layer instead of this particular layer. But here, global average pooling 2D layer did the task of that converting our 3D data into 1D. And then, once this is defined, then what we are doing, we are creating a model based on this. So instead of using sequential API, we are again using functional API. And here we just need to specify like what is input and what is the output. So we are creating a model where we have defined that what is input. So input is same as the input of the base model, and it can accept the images in various sizes. So 128 by 128 is an acceptable dimension that this model can accept. And output will be output layer is like this. So this is our prediction layer, which is a custom layer, and the model will compile this model, and we will perform the training. But it will not take much of the time because already weights are already assigned, and it will just take a little time. And let's compile this model, and then you can see the summary that how the model looks like. So these are the different layers in the model. Okay, now let's compile it. And for compilation, we are using this RMS prop optimizer. Yes, any question? Okay. Yes, Lakshmi ma'am, are you able to understand, or any question?
Sir, I have few questions, sir. I will ask now after you complete.
Okay, okay, no issue. I think you are the only sincere candidate here.
Not sir, like everyone is listening, I think so.
Yes. Okay, so we are using here optimizer as RMS prop. So this is a very kind of de facto optimizer for binary classification problems. And we are using a learning rate of 0.001. So 10 raised to power minus 4 is the learning rate. And from literature, it has been established that whenever you use MobileNet V2 architecture for transfer learning, then 10 raised to power minus 4 is the best learning rate possible. So you wanted to kind of tweak this particular hyperparameter. That's why you have to import it like this, tf.kras.optimizers. Otherwise, it is also available in the form of this taxes thing. If you just write RMS prop, then this optimizer will be in effect. But as we wanted to, keep this learning rate, that's why we have to import it from tf.keras.optimizers.rmsprop. And since we are using binary classification, problem, and we are training a binary classifier, that's why we are using here losses, cross, entropy. So depending on whether it is a multi-classification problem or it is a multi-level, multi-class classification problem, so this, loss will change. It may be categorical cross entropy, it may be sparse categorical cross entropy, or it may be, other types of losses. And during training, we'll be keeping this, we'll be just seeing accuracy, that how well it is improving apart from loss. So here, the matrix or the performance parameter is accuracy, that we will be monitoring, that how it improves. And the most important one is this creating data generators. So now we have our data set available in our drive, and that will be flowing from the our drive to our classifier for the training. And for that, we will be using this image data generator, class that we have imported from this Keras library. And it can give you, various tools and various things by which you can do some sort of data augmentation. You can perform normalization, you can perform scaling, and you can represent your data, you can pre-process your data in the best suitable way. And and this MobileNet V2 architecture can support various types of various dimensions of image data. So either the input image should be in the form of 96x96 or 128x128 or 160. If you're using some other architecture, then you can just Google it, that what are the different image sizes that a particular deep learning model can support. And since this data set is already in the form of 128x128, so it can be used here. But even if it is not in that particular dimension, that you needn't worry. You can specify that at the training time with this one variable, that is target_size, and it will automatically convert your data into this particular dimension before training. Okay, so let's create these data generators, and inside data generator we are passing this hyperparameter, and that is rescale. So whatever image is there, so at every pixel we want to perform this rescaling. So every intensity will be converted into this 1:255 fraction. So every pixel will be multiplied with 1/255. And why we are doing this? Because so that we can get the data in the range of 0 to 1. And why would we like to do that? Because neural networks, convolutional neural networks, work or learn best from the values. So smaller the value, the better will it be suitable for neural network training. So we are doing this rescaling. We are multiplying, we'll be multiplying every pixel with 1/255. So we have intensity range from 0 to 255. That is the maximum possible value that a pixel in an image can have for its intensity. So we'll be just multiplying it with this particular factor, and we'll be getting these two variables, data_gen_train and validation. For training and validation, we are creating these two image data generators separately. And once it is done, then let's look that what is there inside our directory. So this becomes very, very convenient. Keras is very convenient mechanism for doing that. You just need to keep your data into a designated number of folders, and you need to just provide paths for your training data and your validation data, and rest of the things like how many samples are there, and it will be loading them. If it needs to convert the dimension of the data from one size to another size, then it will automatically take care of these things. So we are working on this image, training data, and we have created data_gen_train variable for that. And we are calling this particular function flow_from_directory. So this is a very, very useful function. It will automatically, look for the data in this particular directory. And it will look for first that how many folders are there. So it will automatically, recognize that how many classes are there in your data set. So our data set for training contains two classes, and these two classes have been, placed like this. Like, this is our training folder, and inside that there are two, folders, so cat and dogs. So it will consider the first class, which is chronologically placed in the first place, that is cat. So it will consider that this is class one and this is class two. So it will take, it will come to know this automatically. And this is what flow from directory function does. And here you are providing that where is the training directory and what is the, the size of image that you want to keep. So even if your data set is not into this particular size, and if you specify it 128 by 128, so it will automatically convert and rescale this, your data into a particular dimension. And batch size, that how many images you want to, bring in one batch instead of bringing the entire data, because that is computationally not feasible. But if you want to keep the batch of 128 images, then you can specify this hyperparameter as well. That is 128 images. And the class mode is binary because there are just, two classes, dogs and cats. So you can specify here whether it is binary or it is, multi-class, or what type of classify you want to train. So once you do that, then it has found 2000 images belonging to two classes, and it has calculated this particular stuff automatically. Inside training directory there are two folders, and inside these two classes it has found total 2000 images. So there are 1000 images belonging to each category, and it is doing this automatically. In the same way, we'll generate, we'll create data generators for our validation data as well. So we are having the same, code, and there are 1000 images belonging to two classes. Now, what we need to do, we need to just perform training. And since we are, our data is in the form of image data generators, so we cannot, instead of calling fit function, what we'll do, we'll call this fit_generator, because the data is coming from the image data generators instead of, just from a CSV file or from other, type of data. So here we are doing this, and we need to specify like what is our training data generator. So it has named train_generator, and this is our validation data generator, and we'll train this for just five epochs. It will take some time because there are few thousand images that we are dealing with, so it will take some time, but the training has already been performed. And here you can see that how the accuracy is improved. Still, the accuracy is just like, if you look at the training accuracy, then it is just 79.70, which is not very good, but you can improve it, and you can do something for reducing the overfitting. Like, you can add some data augmentation, and you can unfreeze some of the layers. But this is what it is. There are five epochs, and this is the training accuracy, and this is the validation accuracy on the validation data set. And In first iteration, it was, you know, 51%, and in fifth, it has reached to 79%. And interestingly, you know, the validation accuracy is better. So this generally does not happen. Like, we get validation accuracy, you know, less, and training accuracy, you know, somewhat better. But this is what, you know, looks like. And how to improve this particular accuracy? That can be improved by transfer learning. By fine tuning. So when you are having some, you know, some model, and you are using this as it is without allowing any weight changes in your, you know, network architecture. There is no weight update. So that is one way. Another way, you can unfreeze some of the layers, and you can, after every pass, you can allow the weights to get updated. So how to do that? That can be done with the help of unfreezing some of the layers, and that is called fine tuning. And okay, the training has started. Okay, let's see. So we can see that models, what is the model's accuracy? We can print it. And so validation accuracy. Okay, validation loss and accuracy that we are computing, it would have been computed for more number of epochs. That's why it is showing the accuracy after transfer learning is 97. So now let's understand that what fine tuning is. So fine tuning is that you are allowing some of the weights to get change. And how to allow that weight change? So at the starting in this code, we made this base underscore model dot trainable at false. But what we are doing, we are unfreezing all the, you know, layers that they can update their weights. But it is not a good idea, because if you unfreeze many layers, so again the training you know, time will increase, and the model may not perform that good. So the better idea is to keep some of the layers, you know, freezed, and keep rest of the layers as unfreezed. So there are total 155 layers in this model, and what we'll be doing, we'll be keeping 100 starting 100 layers as freezed, and we'll keep you know, 55 other layers as unfreezed. Unfreezed means that we can update you know, the weights. We can allow the updation of the weights in those layers. So we are fine tuning at layer 100, and what we are doing, layer in base model dot layers. And starting from, you know, zero, from, you know, from the starting index, it will go up to this index, which is fine tune at, and that has value 100. So it will make layer dot trainable as false. So what will it do? It will make the starting 100 layers as untrainable. So the weights will not get updated in those 100 layers, and rest of the 55 layers will modify their weights. And again, we are compiling this model. So optimizer equals to tf.keras.optimizers rms prop. Again, we are compiling this, and we are fine tuning this. And here you can see that when we apply this fine tuning, then in these, you know, five instances only, you can see that when we trained our model without fine tuning, then it gave us the accuracy of 51. But surprisingly, you can see that we have got an accuracy of 92.5 in just first instance after completing of just epoch one. And in every epoch, there are 16, you know, steps. And this is how the accuracy is, you know, kind of changing. And you can see that in just four epochs, we achieved the accuracy of, for training accuracy of 100% in just four epochs. And here you can see that validation, you know, accuracy is also very, very promising. And we have achieved 94% validation accuracy, which is very, you know, promising. And you can apply transfer learning. You can see, you know, because if you create your own convnet architectures, then those may not give you a very promising results. You may get some accuracy of 70, 80, or 85%. But if you apply transfer learning, then you will get some improvement on on the traditional on the basic architectures, and if you couple fine tuning with transfer learning, then you may get some other improvement in your accuracy as well. And less you can see that what is the average accuracy, validation accuracy that you are getting. So you are getting 95.89% of average accuracy. And this is all about, you know, transfer learning, fine tuning, deep learning, and a little bit about, you know, auto Keras and auto encoders. What purpose do they serve? So in these, you know, this limited time of 2 hours, not everything can be, you know, kind of discussed in detail, but this is just a kind of, you know, bird's eye view about this deep learning landscape that I have tried to give you. And we are just, you know, about to finish as we are having 4, you know, 28 already. So I want to keep some time for the discussion.
We have taken only 3,000 data for that is for this particular purpose. But only with that small number of data can we just generalize our accuracy and about the model.
Yes, so that is something, you know, which is very challenging, because I told at the starting, you know, tens of thousands is the general denomination that we talk about in deep learning. So this is really a very, you know, something very challenging. But when we have limited amount of data, so how we can train, you know, our model. So for in that situation, transfer learning is the, you know, ideal tool. And we can couple it with other techniques like fine tuning, data augmentation, and, you know, others, so that we can get some sort of generalized model. It will not be a, you know, kind of 100% accurate generalized model. There will be definitely some sort of overfitting, and we cannot kind of 100% rely on the matrix of accuracy that we are getting. But this is what we can do. And there are many, you know, kind of architectures that have been trained in this way, so that they can be more useful for the end user. Like people are, you know, talking about, you know, one shot or few shot learning. When you are just having in forensics, you know, scenarios, when you are just having limited samples of data and you just want to classify whether an image belongs to a particular category or not. So how you can use it? So there are deep learning architectures that have been trained in that way, so that you can use it as a one-shot learning example. Like you want to train a image recognition, face recognition system. So every face is unique. Like there is biometric face attendance. So the model has been trained on, you know, other samples, but your face does not exist there. But you just want to input one sample of your face and you want to get recognized. So how to do that? So that can be done in few short learning ways. And there are, you know, network architectures that are available there. And that's why transfer learning is beneficial. And this is happening only because of that we applied transfer learning. When we try to apply, you know, apply transfer learning without fine-tuning, then it was just giving us accuracy of 70 or 75%. And had we created our, you know, convnet, like just one sequential stacking of convolutional layer, then max pooling, then convolutional, then max pooling, and then flatten, and then at last dense, then might be our model would be, you know, more overfitted and would have maybe given some, I don't know what accuracy it would have given. But this is just a, you know, kind of mechanism by which we can explore solutions for our particular problem.
Like, so how we can determine the number of layers in an that you are that is already existing network, or if you are creating your own seen and how we can determine the number of that is layers we have to keep, sir?
Yes, so basically number of layers, one idea can be take from, you know, the dimension of the samples. Suppose you are having 10,000 images or you are having 500 images. So if you are having larger data set, then you can go with complex architectures, because complex architectures need more data so that they can learn complex kind of formula or functions. But if you just want to have simple, you know, just a smaller data set, so you want to keep the architecture to be very, you know, small. You would like to add regularization, you want to add some sort of pruning and some sort of, you know, dropout so that the model does not overfit. So overfitting have that, there is a class third maths paper and you are asking a PhD student to attempt it. So the person is already having so much that he has learned, but if you want to, you know, ask the person to learn something like it is 2 plus 2 equals to 4, 3 plus 3 equals to 6, and 8 plus 8 equals to 16. So if you show these examples to any person and you do not, you know, tell any logic, like you have just created 5 samples and you have just defined a random logic, like 2 plus 2 equals to 9, 7 plus 3 equals to 10, and 1 plus 1 equals to 18. And you are using 2 samples for training and you are using 1 sample for testing. So, or you are just, you know, creating it otherwise. So if the samples are limited and the architecture is complex, so it is most likely that instead of learning discriminative features, the model has memorized the features and the corresponding classes. So it is performing well on the training set, but when you show it some unseen data, so it does not perform that. So complex architectures are definitely a boon and a kind of bane as well. And you need to see that how much of data you have and how complex your architecture is, what are the validation matrix and what are the test matrix and what are the, you know, training matrix, and how to optimize it, whether to apply regularization, whether to apply dropout, whether to apply transfer learning, whether to apply fine tuning, or whether to add some data augmentation to improve it further.
Thank you, sir.
You're most welcome. And thank you for, you know, for being so patient. Yes, I would like to see other faces and want to hear other voices as well.
So I have a doubt. So I'm very new to this transfer learning. Just today I heard about it and I learned about it. So thank you for that. And before that, I just want to ask a few questions. Like in transfer, you have explained everything about transfer learning and image kind of things and all. So in which cases it is going to fail for sure, sir? That is the field I just want to know.
Okay, for image classification, in which scenario it's going to fail?
Yes.
Okay, so it will fail in, you know, 2-3 scenarios for sure, when you are having, you know, limited number of samples. And the second scenario may be when there is very less discrimination or, you know, kind of inter-class dissimilarity. Suppose when you are trying to classify whether it is white egg or it's brown egg, and you are just having 10 samples, so it will be very difficult to discriminate, because, you know, the discriminative features is special, and you know, other sort of features may fail because they may exist the similar shape, and only a very very little discriminative knowledge may exist and the samples are less. So when you have, you know, less discrimination among classes and when the number of samples are less, it may fail.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
So thank you so much. This these resources are I have already shared with you. You just download them and you may practice at your own pace. Thank you.
From the participants. So if there are no queries further, then we are done for the day. Of course, sir will be available tomorrow also. He'll be discussing on a case study. Even if you have any doubts, you can ask sir tomorrow also. And thank you, sir, very much once again for your patient lecturing. And sir, yeah, I think you have already shared. There were some messages to share. Ask the link to share again. So once again, we are happy, sir, for your to listen to you again. I am particularly happy to listen to you once again.
Thank you so much, sir. It's always a pleasure to connect with Central University of Tamil Nadu and to interact with you. Thank you.
Yes, sir. And we'll close the session now and we'll meet tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock sharply.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, sir. Bye.